Thank you very much for this opportunity to come and speak at this climate conference. I think this is the first time I've been in a conference where focus is climate, not energy system. But so far I spent a lot of time thinking about what should be my title and decided to be on district heating, the key to a smart integrated energy system. Well, Danish District Heating Association was I was presented as coming from, but I'm also representing something called Grøn Energi. Grøn Energi is a union on innovative accelerating the green transition, but is closely related to Danish District Heating Association. So therefore, it's obvious that I'm talking about district heating. So first, why did I choose the title? District heating, the key to a smart integrated energy system. If you start from behind, you can say from the back of it, energy system. Well, energy system is because that we have a challenge to meet the climate goals. And in solving these this challenge, the energy system is definitely very, very important. I'll show that later on. Then you can say smart integrated. Well, what does that mean? You can say integrated the energy system. We have been focusing on for quite a while. But what is smart? For me, smart is some kind of balance between minimum system cost, maximum green, maximum benefit, well, CO2 focus, whatever. And I think there could be a lot more bullets up here. And I think that about every people talking about smartness has their own definition or their own balance between these. And of course, I also do. So for me, a smart system is a balance in this one. And then you say, what is the balance? And I am pretty much focused on the system cost and the CO2. Then the district heating as the key. I stole this picture, I would say, from the internet. I think it's Wind Power of Denmark that has the origin of it. And a lot of these pictures, when you focus on what is an integrated energy system, when you see what is the integration, then it's hard to come about that is not within the district heating. I'm sorry for it being in Danish. I hope you can sort of get the feel of it anyway. I mean, it's not important the exact points that is going into the system. The point is that in the figure is that there's an electricity system, there's a gas system, there's a water system, and there's a district heating system, and it's integrated. And in the middle of this, as illustrated here, is the district heating system. Back to the climate change challenge that we have. I just have a few slides here showing a little bit what we can actually do with this, because we think, okay, everything can be done by the energy system, but that's not true. First, what is it? Well, the goal of CO2 emission in Denmark has to be reduced by 70% in 2030. That's the new governmental goal for it. In 1990, we had an emission of 70.4 million tons of CO2. Well, it's very easy to calculate that in 2030 it's allowed to have 30% of the 1990, which is 21 million tons. In 2016, there was 50 million tons. And we can say, so we have reduced, I can't record the number when they're here somewhere. Maybe I'll just pick it up. So in 26 years from 90 to 16, it was reduced by 28%. So we need to reduce it the last 42% in 14 years. So we really have to accelerate how we do this. If we look at how this is distributed, this 16 emissions, this was the last credible numbers that I could get. Then we can see on the, what is it, your left side there, what is split into the energy and transformation sector, which is 28%. The transportation is 26%. Then we have some agriculture and industry, and we have some commercial and public services, and which is also the households. And then we have some emission from the agriculture, which is 20%. So if you take just the largest bits of this, the energy system, of course, is some of it. then the transportation is a lot of it. And we have the emissions from the agriculture parts. And we just have on the right side here, I've shown what is the share of the energy and transformation sector. You can see 19% go to the energy sector, which I'm not quite sure what is. Then you have electricity production of the 57%, and you have district heating production of 24%. And I don't know that the district heating emission for the time being is 2.8 or something like that million tons. So even if the district heating reduces the emissions to zero, it's only 24% of the 28%, which will count for the less than 3 million tons of the, what, 40 million we were lacking, or 30 million tons we were lacking. So it's not counting very much. But what we think could be the case here is that district heating can actually go in and help in some of the other sectors in this one. For example, the commercial and the public sector. So we can actually go into some more households to help solve this emission problem or challenge, you can say. And also in some industry cases that we can be trying to innovate and develop new innovative solutions where we can actually sort of help this problem to be solved. So, back to the energy system, because of course I'm only into energy systems, so therefore that's what I know the most about. So, if you look back at the energy consumption and production, how it has been, and now I'm only taking the electricity and the district heating numbers at this talk, we can see that for a long history of time, we have had, this is the orange figure on the left side here, we have had more or less constant electricity use up to now. We can also see that the light blue here in the bottom is that we are coming along with the renewable production of this is the wind turbines. So electricity is expected to be more or less renewable or CO2 free within some time frame. And at least we can see a way in this. And this is possible. The district heating, which is on the right side here, we can also see it has got more or less constant consumption or production for at least the last, what, 10, 20 years. So that is also stagnating, we can say. We also see a way where district heating more or less can become CO2 neutral. Right now, I mean, we have a very, very efficient way of producing both electricity and heat by all these co-produced units, but that is not to, I mean, that has become less and less in the recent years. If we look at outlooks for what is going to be the consumption and the production of electricity and district heating, the Energy Agency produces outlooks for planning of the energy system. And this is from the 2019 outlook. We can see that the electricity consumption is expected to increase quite a bit. And we can also see what it's used for, and one of the big changes in this one is actually that a lot of it is going to data centers. I think they're planning on 17% of the Danish electricity consumption in 2030 should be used by data centers. The idea of data centers is, of course, that to store and process data. But when you use a lot of electricity in a data center, it becomes heat, waste heat, or excess heat. And what we can do with that is that we can put that into the district heating system. But what is sort of is not understandable to me is that the Energy Agency is not expecting the consumption of district heating to increase. So it will stay the same, And so it will, of course, push some other district heating production out of the equation. And we don't know what it's going to be yet. What we would like, of course, is to have the district heating to expand wherever it sort of gives meaning, is meaningful. So the point here is that we can actually collect a lot of sources of heat that is not otherwise possible. Well, it's coming on this slide. You can say that how district heating enables integration. District heating is the simplest and cheapest energy storage in the system. So it's much cheaper than batteries to have hot water in a tank or in a pond or whatever we have it. So that's for one thing. The other thing is that it collects heat that is otherwise wasted. So for a number of years, co-production of electricity and heating has been a very efficient way of generating both electricity and heat. But as we are not using the same, you can say, inputs like coal, gas, whatever, biomass is not, I mean, is that still renewable, to some discussion at least, and used for co-production of electricity and heat? Then that has been efficient. Then there's a lot of focus right now on the excess heat from industry. And I know at least one up here that's sitting to utilize excess heat from supermarkets is a challenge in Denmark, but that's the regulatory issues that's going into this. Then we can discuss whether this excess heat is actually cooling we should be selling to, for example, the data centers. That is also for discussion and to try to think of this in new ways so we can develop these synergies to other sectors and other industries. And that's, I mean, actually how we could sort of get into this other part of this pie chart that I was showing in the beginning. And then finally, that district heating is collecting, I don't know if this is enables integration as much, but it's at least helping for the climate challenge that we are facing, that we can collect from other sources than individual sources of heating actually is possible, like solar heating and geothermal heating, which is very much discussed in Denmark for the time being. Then you can say, okay, we have places where we have already established district heating, what can they do? And we have new places if we develop new land. In this slide, we have already established district heating system. How can we increase integration in these parts of the system? If there's capacity in the existing system, then it's pretty obvious. It's just a matter of connecting the people. And it will probably be more green with a green district heating system, which will be easier to transform rather than maybe 10,000 of individual households. If there's not capacity in the existing system, it can be either because there's bottlenecks in the infrastructure, you can say in the piping on the lines, or it can be short of production. I mean, short on the heat to go into the system. And there's a project going on actually in Aarhus, so I have sort of just stolen, what you can say, the results. Well, I'm part of the project, so I think it's okay. Where they try to investigate and model and calculate on different of these solutions of this. And what we're looking at is actually to activate local flexibility in the buildings. How can we actually, because when we talk about there's a shortage or there's not capacity, it's not in all hours. It's maybe 10, 15, or it's very few peak hours. So it's a matter of what can be done in a few hours for a whole system to work. So maybe we can have activated some local flexibility in those you can say, peak hours that is the problem. Another possibility is to build local production. It could be a heat pump or boiler or something very locally. It could be to build some storage facilities to cover these few hours locally, or it could be to increase the infrastructure. It's sort of having, giving the option, which is not quite so obvious, but we need to have it sort of modeled and showed. So that's what we're looking at, if there's bottlenecks in the network. If we are short on production, it's a matter of, then we need some more heat from somewhere to come into the system. It can either be to optimize, to place this locally, some places, and that's very much what's done in geothermal solution, where you actually not put it in one place. I mean, that's sort of also the nature. You want to have it from different places in the ground, so it's not too close. Or you can build very flexible capacity to produce. And then the storage is again coming in. So that's what we are looking at for these existing houses. Then what I was mentioning on the new areas or the new developed lands. Then you can say, okay, should there be district heating in new areas or not? And this discussion comes up because the houses that are built nowadays are so low energy houses that you're talking about zero energy houses, nearly zero, or I mean very, very low energy consumption house in these houses. And I don't think that district heating should be everywhere. I think you should be careful when you sort of do planning, and that's also why Lisa's talk was very interesting, because these planning aspects of this is very difficult. So I can understand why municipal communities have problems in planning, because it's not easy. And when should people be allowed to decide themselves what to do, and when should you as a community decide something? That is also an issue you have to take up. In this example, I mean, I think there's a misinterpretation between, well, more things. But one thing is when it can pay off to have district heating, or when it's cost effective. So we did an analysis a year ago or so where we looked into different consumption levels in new houses. So it was very low, and you have low, and you have medium, and you have what it had today. And then we look into what is the distance between the houses. So you can say some kind of the density of the population. And this is at a certain the density. This figure on the right here showed that even with low energy houses, not very low power energy houses, but low energy houses at a certain density. And then there's different sources of heating here. We have the line on here is reflecting the district heating, which is the first column, and the cost of splitting into some doesn't matter. And then you have some individual heating technologies here that you can use. You can oil, wood pellets, natural gas, electric heating, I mean plain electric heating, and air to water with a heat pump and a ground source heat pump. And with the level of what we have of taxation today, it's actually so that the electric heating in a low energy house is cheaper than having a heat pump. But it is actually cost effective to have district heating, even with the laid out pipeline and all this cost I included in this. So, getting a fair discussion on when cost effective district heating is applicable, I think is necessary, you can say. Then there's another, you can say, misinterpretation or lack of discussion here, because when you build new houses, you are obliged to follow the Danish building rules. And according to Danish building rules, you get a permit to build a house that has a certain standard, it's insulation, windows, etc. And in this analysis, I've borrowed from Martin up in the corner there, so I'm sure he can explain a lot more on that. It's from individual households in Aarhus that was built in 2016 and 17, and he extracted all data from 2018, all the consumption data for 2018 for what was used. And what we can see in this is that these houses use at least twice as what the building regulation allowed them to use. So they use much more energy than what is planned for, because you of course plan for what they are allowed to use. So that leaves us with a lot of problems, because what should the district energy or district heating system be planning for them? So I also think this is it has been up for discussion at several times, but it's not discussed enough, and it's not taken into planning decisions enough. So this is actually my last slide. So what is the development trends in district heating to increase this smartness, I think? Well, within the next years, there's going to be a lot of large investments. There has been sort of a lack of investments for a while due to some political issues in Denmark, but they now really need to come on, and the focus is here on electrification. The focus is also on diversification of the production. So you are sort of both have electric heat pumps into the district heating system, you also have storages, you also have biomass, so you have a lot of different technologies going into this. And then maybe should be the fact there, because this regulatory framework is so important, and there's so many aspects of the regulatory framework. Here I mentioned the taxes and tariffs. You can say, if you come to the last corner here, the planning is also a regulatory aspect. And it has become really, really difficult. Then they have become much more into what's the risk management of this, because a lot can change. I mean, things are changing a lot faster within the last 5 years than it has been for a long time. And so there are so many game changers coming, and one is digitalization. What is that going to do with this? We are discussing that a lot. So we are building on how to utilize all this data we get in and how to create value of it. And I think that's going to be a game changer for what is going to happen in this integrated system. So therefore, I think there's a lot going to, and do not forget, district heating is also a smart option to have in the future.
Thank you, Nina. That was very exciting. So is there one question? It's up there. Yeah, it's a long one. He doesn't need to go to the fitness today.
Thank you for the presentation. I have two short questions. I'll try to condense them in one. When you showed the diagram of what we expect for the 20 coming years of consumption in the district heating, we can't really see it decreasing so much. So between the lines, we are not expecting strong energy and efficiency improvements there. Is that correct? Or do we expect the expansion of district heating to compensate for energy efficiency?
The second option. We expect that there's so many more coming in that you will make up for the efficiencies.
Okay.
That was what your question was, eh?
Yes,
yeah.
Exactly. And then a very short one, also when you talk about the 70% reduction, did you talk just about the energy sector or for the full emissions in Denmark?
This is the full emissions in Denmark. And this one is the full emissions in Denmark, and this is the energy system sector.
Okay, so you're also not expecting that it's a 70% reduction in the district heating sector, because district heating is sort of low-hanging fruit in the picture. so that we would expect that we reduce by more than 70% by 2030.
Yes, I expect us to be close to zero in 2030.